Yeah. That's what I need. Oh. Now it's serious. Oh. That one's just, yeah, that one's good. All right. Good morning, everyone, and welcome to CCCBR English Worship Service this morning. Whether you're tuning in from YouTube Live or if you're here right here in our sanctuary, we're still also welcome, or we're also thankful that you could be here with us this morning. Why don't you guys stand up and let's worship together this morning. Ready? One, two, three. And this is amazing grace that you've given us, Lord. Who breaks the power? Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in dumb wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You lay down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, whoa, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. And who brings our chaos? Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory. Who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You lay down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, whoa, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. And worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. And worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, 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 oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You lay down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, whoa, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. We join together wherever we are to sing praises to the Lamb this morning. We give glory to the Lamb who has set us free. Through the Lamb we have freedom. And today, in singing our praises to God, we join with the members of heaven, giving worship to the Lamb who is worthy. We are a kingdom, priests, serving our God. What a great privilege this is. Thank you all for joining us this morning. And as we continue to worship the Lord, let's turn to Him now in prayer. Lord, you are worthy. Thank you for setting us free. In you, we are free. We have freedom in you. When you came to the earth, Father, that was our Independence Day. Father, we pray now, in a time of confession, we take a moment to remember any sin, whether in thought, word, and deed, what we have done or what we have failed to do. We are truly sorry. Father, thank you for the forgiveness that we have through your Son, Jesus. Accept our offering of praise, Lord, as we take off our crowns and cast them before your feet. Continue to work among us. Receive the praise that is due to you. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name. We have peace with God and with one another through the Lord Jesus Christ. Let's take this opportunity to share with one another the sign of peace.
Together we sing Alleluia.
Alleluia. Alleluia. For the Lord God Almighty reigns. Alleluia. God Almighty reigns. Alleluia. And holy, holy are you, Lord God Almighty. Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb. Holy, holy are you, Lord God Almighty. Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb. Amen.
Sing it together, church. We sing Alleluia.
Alleluia. Alleluia. For the Lord God Almighty reigns. Alleluia. Alleluia. For the Lord God Almighty reigns. Alleluia. And holy, holy are you, Lord God Almighty. Worthy is the Lamb, worthy is the Lamb. Holy, holy are you, Lord God Almighty. Worthy is the Lamb, worthy is the Lamb. You are holy, holy are you, Lord God Almighty. Worthy is the Lamb, worthy is the Lamb. And holy, holy are you, Lord God Almighty. Worthy is the Lamb, worthy is the Lamb. You are holy, holy are you, Lord God Almighty. Worthy is the Lamb, worthy is the Lamb. And holy, holy are you, Lord God Almighty. Worthy is the Lamb, worthy is the Lamb. And amen.
Keep fighting voices.
And I keep fighting voices in my mind that say I'm not enough. And every single lie that tells me I will never measure up. Am I more than just the sum of every high and every low? Remind me once again just who I am, because I need to know. Oh, you say I am loved. When I can't feel a thing, you say I am strong. When I think I am weak, you say I am held. When I am falling short, when I don't belong, oh, you say I am yours. And I believe, oh, I believe what you say of me. I believe. The only thing that matters now is everything you think of me. In you I find my worth, in you I find my identity. Whoa. You say I am loved when I can't feel a thing. You say I am strong when I think I'm weak. You say I am held when I am falling short. When I don't belong, oh, you say I am yours. And I believe, oh, I believe what you say of me. I believe. When taking all I have and now I'm laying it at your feet. And you'll have every failure, God, you'll have every victory. Whoa. You say I am loved when I can't feel a thing. You say I am strong when I think I am weak. You say I am held when I am falling short. When I don't belong, oh, you say,
sing it again, you say,
and you say, oh, I'm loved and I can't feel a thing. You say I am strong when I think I'm weak. You say I am held when I am falling short. When I don't belong, oh, you say I am yours. And I believe, oh, I believe what you say of me. I believe, yes, I believe, oh, I believe what you say of me. I believe.
Awesome. Amen. Let's bow our head together. Bow our heads together and pray. God, thank you for letting us come together to worship you once again on another beautiful Sunday. Father, I pray as we continue to maneuver through this obstacle that we have in front of us with social distancing and the pandemic and all the things that are going on in the world, I'm thankful that we can still be unified together on this day to worship and to praise your holy name. Father, I pray that as we come out of a time of celebrating independence and freedom and being with family and being together with loved ones, I pray that we can remember that we can express our freedom to worship you and our freedom to come here and to bow down at your feet, to listen to what you have to say for us, Father. Again, through all this turmoil, through all this chaos that's going on in the world, I pray that we can continue to strive to get to a place where we can return somewhat to normal, Father. I pray that we can continue to seek guidance. I pray that we can continue to stay strong as a nation. I pray that we can continue to stay strong as a community here in Baton Rouge to get together and to spread your love, Father. I pray for all of those that are hurting right now. I pray for all of those that don't seem to have anywhere else to go. I pray that they can come to you. I pray that anybody that is a Christian can reach out to the masses and spread that message of hope and joy and love to people that need it the most. Continue to pray for everybody that's still vulnerable to the sickness, that's still hurting in some way, I pray that they can continue to just keep looking and keep searching for hope, because that's what we are. We're fighters, Lord, and you've called us to fight the good fight. You've called us to equip ourselves with the knowledge and the love and the compassion to anybody that we meet in our lives. We thank you for every opportunity and every blessing. We thank you for all of the relationships that we have with friends, with family, with whomever. We pray that we can make them fruitful and that we can continue to strive to further your kingdom here on this earth, Father. Again, I thank you for everything that you've done, and it's in Jesus' name that I pray. Amen. Awesome. You may have a seat. Well, good morning again, everyone. If you have your Bibles, today's scripture will be in Revelations. So if you guys want to flip to that. And we're going to be in Revelations chapter 1, verses 1 through 8. Okay. All right, Revelation 1, verse 1. The revelation from Jesus Christ, which God gave him to show his servants what must soon take place. He made it known by sending his angel to his servant John, who testifies to everything he saw, that is, the word of God and the testimony of Jesus Christ. Blessed is the one who reads aloud the words of this prophecy, and blessed are those who hear it and take to heart what is written in it, because the time is near. John, to the seven churches in the province of Asia, grace and peace to you from him who is and who was and who is to come, and from the seven spirits before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead, and the ruler of the kings of the earth. To him who loves us and has freed us from our sins by his blood, and has made us to be a kingdom and priests to serve his God and Father, to him be glory and power forever and ever. Amen. Look, he is coming with the clouds, and every eye will see him, even those who pierced him, and all peoples on earth will mourn because of him. So shall it be. Amen. I am the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord God, who is and who was and who is to come, the Almighty.
This week, our reading is from the beginning of the book of Revelation. The book begins with a statement about what it principally is. The first words read, "The revelation of Jesus Christ, which he gave to John." And we heard read a salutation given to those who read the book, and a word of praise to Jesus, and a reflection on who Jesus is. John writes, "To him who loves us and freed us from our sins by his blood, and made us to be a kingdom, priests serving his God." The book of Revelation is, as one author put it, a terrible book. And the author meant terrible in two senses. It is terrible, he says, in the original sense of the word, as terror-inducing. The visions that Revelation records include scenes of judgment, of pestilence and famine, and of great beasts and other creatures terrorizing the earth. There are woes and seal judgments, there are frightful figures, and there is death of a large number of people. The book is terrible in this sense, but it is also terrible in the sense of awe-inspiring. Revelation's imagery can evoke fear, but it also, and even to a greater extent, evokes hope. We've talked many times about the image at the end of Revelation, the image of the New Jerusalem coming down from heaven. The scene vividly depicts the eventual renewal of the earth as the new city, which has God, comes to be there. There is a river there signaling prosperity and life with the security of its great walls. The vision comes at the end of Revelation, but images of hope punctuate the entire book. Revelation 4-5 includes one such image where before we see the opening of the seal of judgment, we are brought into the throne room where we encounter for the first time in the book the image of the Lamb. John said that he was caught up into the throne room of God, which is absolutely abuzz with energy. The throne of God is there, and around the throne there are 24 more thrones, thrones of the 24 elders who are also there. And around the thrones are a great number of living beasts who, with the elders, give worship to the one who is seated on the throne. The imagery is rich and colorful and full of energy, and just begs to be portrayed in visual media. Then in Revelation 5, there is the scene with the Lamb. Revelation 5 states that as John watched, they searched for someone who would open the seals in the hand of the one seated on the throne. No one, it says, on heaven or on earth was found worthy to open the seals. But then the vision takes us to a Lamb standing at the front of the throne, who takes the scroll and is able to open it. This Lamb, it says, is the Lion of the tribe of Judah. But it is precisely as the Lamb, the one who was slaughtered, that the Lamb conquered, and that the Lamb is worthy. And as the elders see the Lamb, and the Lamb takes the scroll, it says they begin to worship him. It says they sing a new song to him. You are worthy to take the scroll and to open its seals, for you were slaughtered, and by your blood you ransomed for God saints from every tribe and language and people and nation. You have made them to be a kingdom, priests serving our God, and they will reign on the earth. This scene comes just before the opening of seals and the portrayal of judgments in chapter 6 and following. This is an image of hope. The Lamb ransomed for God saints from every tribe, establishing among the nations a people, a kingdom through his blood, and they will reign on the earth. The image parallels what we heard in Revelation 1. Jesus, who is the Lamb, founds a people, sets them free, and they will live with him. The Lamb, who is also the Lion of Judah, conquers, and it is precisely as the Lamb that he conquers. When I talk with people about the book of Revelation, what inevitably comes up in the conversation is the topic of the ultimate end of history and whether I think we are currently or soon will be experiencing it. Revelation has been read as, above all, a chronological account of the precise sequence of events that lead up to the catastrophic end of history. Whether we know it or not, we have been shaped in our reading of Revelation by films like these. I don't know how many of you have seen any of the films represented here. This one is getting older now. I think that came out in 97. Armageddon, starring Bruce Willis and Ben Affleck very early in his career, portrayed a giant meteor on trajectory to hit the earth and end life as we know it. Of course, Bruce Willis and the gang swoop in at the nick of time. Terminator, the Terminator series, also depicts an apocalyptic, as we use this term, apocalyptic event, which they're trying to avoid. And then the Left Behind series, which itself is, in fact, based on a reading of Revelation. Today, however, I want to push back against the association of the book of Revelation with these films. Rather than being an account of the linear sequence of events leading up to a future end of history, akin to these films, Revelation is more about how we make sense of and live within our present world, the world around us. Today, I want us to see that our reading of Revelation has more to gain from a different film, that is, The Matrix, than the films Armageddon, Independence Day, or Terminators, and even the film Left Behind, which is itself based on a reading of Revelation. How many of you have seen The Matrix? How many of you have seen Matrix 2 and 3? Okay. The first one's better than the others. I think we can all agree. For those of you who have not seen the film The Matrix or saw it a long time ago, I will give you a brief summary of its plot. And The Matrix came out in 1999. Spoiler alert, if you haven't seen the film, you've had 21 years to do so, so that's on you. The Matrix is the story of a man named Thomas Anderson, who is a computer programmer by day and a hacker who goes by the name of Neo at night. Neo has never been satisfied with the world. He has always thought that something is wrong with the world, but has never been able to discover what it is. Neo, through his constant searching through the darkest places of the internet, comes repeatedly to encounter the phrase, the Matrix, but he does not know what that means. Eventually, he meets a woman named Trinity, who says that a man named Morpheus has been searching for him, and that Morpheus will be able to tell him what he wants to know. Neo and Morpheus finally meet. Morpheus tells Neo all that he knows about Neo, how he knows Neo has never been satisfied with life, that he has always had this sense, as Neo says, like a splinter in his mind that drives him mad. Morpheus asks, "Do you want to know what the Matrix is?" Neo says, "Yes." Then Morpheus famously offers Neo two pills. Neo can choose the blue pill and will wake up in his bed the next day unchanged, believing anything he wants about the world. Or he can take the red pill, stay in Wonderland, and see how deep the rabbit hole goes. And here we have, this is Neo, this is Morpheus, Trinity, and this is the scene where Morpheus is offering Neo the red pill or the blue pill. Neo chooses the red pill. As we come to learn, the Matrix is the simulated reality in which Neo's mind has been planted all his life. The world in which he lives, the world of 20th century modern society, Morpheus explains, is a simulated reality to which his consciousness has been uploaded by intelligent machines. It is the world, Morpheus says, that has been pulled over your eyes to blind you from the truth. In the real world, Neo's body is kept in a small cell where his body heat is harvested to serve as an energy supply for the robots who have enslaved Neo, and with him all humans who are trapped in this way. What appears in the film The Matrix is an instance of what we in Greek call apocalypse, which is the first word of the book of Revelation and where the book gets its name. Apocalypse means an unveiling, a peeling back of the curtain to see what lays behind it. Morpheus tells Neo that he does not understand the reality of the world which he has lived in all his life. Saint John the Apostle says the same thing. His vision is an apocalypse, an unveiling of how things really are, though we cannot understand it without the revelation. In the scene in which Morpheus meets Neo, Morpheus tells Neo that the world that he knows, the one that he has known all his life, is a veil that has kept him from seeing the truth. The truth that Neo is a slave. Neo is subject to powers that he was not aware were acting upon him and keeping him in bondage. The book of Revelation offers a parallel account of reality. The powers are not super intelligent machines, and the enslavement is not a small cube. The powers are the cosmological forces at work in the world: sin, Satan, death. In the world John presents, which is our world, there is a struggle between human beings, the forces of sin, and between God and the Lamb. The book of Revelation would have us to see our world in terms of this world. The world that it speaks of is this world. The forces at work in its vision are forces at work among us. And the Lamb is both the model for our own faithful witness and the one who will achieve victory for us. John, the author of Revelation, is, like Morpheus in The Matrix, helping us to see that the world that lay behind the veil, the world in which we are caught up as people living in the 21st century in the USA. And this world, the real world in which we live, John teaches, is both more terrible and also more beautiful than we realize. There is the power of sin and agents of evil. Disaster and famine come upon the land, and the world sees the influence of the evil one. Yet John also gives us the picture of the triumphant Lamb, who is worthy to open the scrolls, who receives heavenly praises, and with whom we, along with the rest of the saints, are united. And Revelation teaches us something relevant for our present moment as a society. As just yesterday, the U.S. celebrated its Independence Day. The U.S. has throughout its history held freedom as a core value. The Declaration of Independence formally declared its freedom from British rule. The Pledge of Allegiance voices its commitments to liberty and justice for all. Freedom has become a slogan representing America, or something that represents America's political and economic commitments. The Constitution is instituted, as it says, to secure the blessings of liberty for ourselves and our posterity. And the cause of freedom has even been given as a rationale for war. The book of Revelation places a question mark over all human attempts to achieve freedom, liberation, by human means, by government policy, or, and especially, by means of the human exercise of force. The book of Revelation calls into question the extent to which human government in such forms of society as set out in the Constitution can achieve the freedom they hold out and which we want. The book of Revelation also calls us to think about what allegiance we as Christians have to the human societies in which we find ourselves. As the passage of Revelation we heard from today states, Jesus is the one who frees us from our sin. And as Christians, we are part of a different kingdom, a kingdom that was founded when Jesus came to the earth. This is our Independence Day, and we as Christians have to think about all other Independence Days in relation to this one. Our understanding of our own identity and our own Independence Day does not, it should not mean, that we do not give thanks for the forms of liberty that we experience in the U.S., nor does it mean that we as a community living in the U.S. ought to be unconcerned about efforts for liberty and justice in the country. On the contrary, we should be grateful for the forms of liberty we enjoy, and we should promote, where we are able, efforts for liberty and justice for all people, as I hope and pray and know that our community has been doing. We do this because such is characteristic of the kingdom of God. But at the same time, we should look at skepticism on efforts to establish liberty, justice, and peace on the earth through human means and by human efforts. And we should also be willing to search deeply national claims to be committed to liberty and justice. When used by human governments and individuals, these can in many cases be little more than words that serve as a pretext to serve one's own interests, including often through the use of violent force. Again, this does not mean that we retreat from bearing witness in the public square or that we are open to conspiracy theories. But it does mean that we will be skeptical of the extent to which the world will accomplish reform and be open to reform and become a world where liberty and justice are truly for all. The book of Revelation, then, is a book that helps us as Christians to pull back the veil and see the world as it truly is, to peel back the veil so that we can see the world in all its reality. One important Christian author has remarked on the tense history of the church's relationship with the book of Revelation, and comments that the book should play a more important role in our community life than it often has. The author, Michael Gorman, writes, "Perhaps in a profound way, the last book of the Bible needs to become the church's first book. The book of Revelation is meant to help us see the world as it truly is, and in seeing this world, better being able to follow the Lamb who alone sets us free and leads us into the New Jerusalem."
Please join me in praying to our Father for ourselves, our family, community, and the entire world. The response to "Lord, hear us" will be "Lord, graciously hear us." Dear Father God, we come to you to pray for guidance, for we know you will lead our path straight. Open our eyes to what may be good for us, our community, and our world. Lead us to make choices that glorify you, whether those be personal, social, or political. We pray you show us how to see others in the world through your lens. Continue to guide our leadership within the church to make good decisions for our community here, and guide our country and world leaders to continue making the best choices for the health and well-being of us all. Lord, hear us. Dear Father God, we pray for patience and kindness, two fruits of the Spirit that at times we may easily lose sight of. In our world where information and opinions can be given and received in the matter of seconds, we pray that you may show us how to slow down and be patient in our responses. Let us patiently listen to others, go back to you to seek wisdom, and respond with an abundance of kindness. Show us, God, how we may be kind to others who may not be kind to us, or whom we may not share the same views with. We pray to you that you may overflow our cups of patience and kindness so that we shall never feel dry in those areas. Lord, hear us. Dear Father God, we pray for joy. 2020 has already brought us many emotions, including fear, sadness, disappointment, and anger. We pray now more than ever for you to refresh our hearts. Show us how not to just dwell in the negative feelings, but rejoice because we have you. Let us feel the joy of our salvation and the love you continue to show us, no matter what kind of time we are going through. We pray to be reminded of how big you are as a God, and allow us to celebrate and be joyous in that. Lord, hear us. Dear Father God, we pray for those who have been economically affected by COVID. Many have taken a loss to their wages, jobs or careers, and even businesses. So we lift up all these people to you. Bless over them, give them comfort during this hard time, provide opportunity and guidance to these people. We pray you may show us how to love on our brothers and sisters who may be in this situation. Allow us to be your vessels so that we may shine your light in these dark times. Lord, hear us. Dear Father God, we pray that you inspire us to use our time we have now earnestly. We pray that you may reveal to each and every one of us something we may need to improve on so that we may continue to grow during this time. For those of us who have extra time on our hands now, show us how we may use it to grow closer to you, our community, or even ourselves. Guide us in using self-control and discipline to do these things. Lord, hear us. Dear Father God, we thank you for listening to us. We thank you for all the moments of joy, peace, safety, and love you have given us, big and small. We will continue to look towards you for guidance and lean on you for all of our needs. We love you very much. In your holy name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor Daniel, for that message. Why don't we all stand together and come together once again and worship with one final song before we leave for today. At the beginning, Lord. You were the Word at the beginning, one with God the Lord Most High. Your hidden glory in creation, now revealed in you our Christ. What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus. You didn't want heaven without us, so Jesus, you brought heaven down. My sin was great, your love was greater. What could separate us now? What a wonderful name it is. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a wonderful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus. Death could not hold you. And death could not hold you. The veil tore before you. You silenced the boast of sin and grave.
The heavens are roaring, the praise of your glory, for you are raised to life again. You have no rival, you have no equal, now and forever, God, you reign. Yours is the kingdom, yours is the glory, yours is the name above all names. What a powerful name it is, what a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is, nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus.
Death could not hold you.
Death could not hold you. The veil tore before you. You silenced the boast of sin and grave. The heavens are roaring, the praise of your glory, for you are raised to life again. And you have no rival, you have no equal, now and forever, God, you reign. And yours is the kingdom, yours is the glory, yours is the name above all names. What a powerful name it is, what a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is, and nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus.
All right. Amen. All right. Y'all may have a seat.
What a powerful name is the name of Jesus. As we come to a close, I have just a couple of announcements to share with you. The first is for our church members, an email about the Chinese minister candidate process was sent to you all last week. There is the ongoing matter of the approval of our Chinese minister candidate, Brother Xiaoyan Liu. And if you have not yet voted on that and you are a member, then check your emails, make sure that you have that email, and take part in that. The voting for that will close at 10 p.m. tomorrow. And the other announcement is simply that sign up for on-site worship remains open. Sign up for next week is open, and for weeks following that. If you would like to attend on-site here, sign-up is necessary, remains necessary. So get in touch with us and make known that you would like to join us. We would love to welcome you here. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Let's stand and sing our doxology together.